Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. If I may have your attention, we will be beginning shortly. I'll kindly ask those of us in the breakfast area, please, to begin to make our way into the auditorium. We will be starting shortly. Okay, so good morning, distinguished honorable guests. It is a pleasure to have you here this morning. Join us for the third high-level meeting on country-led knowledge sharing. We are very grateful that you have made the trip and honored our invitation to grace this occasion. My name is Tweety Uzele, and I'm a senior knowledge and learning officer with the LLI CC team, and I will be our conference MC. A very warm welcome to you. Before we open formally, kindly allow me to make some housekeeping announcements just to ensure we have an enabling environment and everybody is at peace regarding our surrounding. Firstly, in case you may not have noticed, we have simultaneous translation happening, and I will just remind us about the channels. We have English on channel 1. We have French on channel 2. We have Spanish in channel 3 and Russian on channel 4. So please feel free to adjust to the language that is most comfortable to you during these deliberations. Secondly, this morning as you came in, or yesterday if you registered yesterday, you received a participant bag that contains the resources that you require for these 2 days. You have found in there our program for the day. So feel free to follow along with that as a guide for our day, for our speakers, but I will be here at hand to walk us through them every step of the way. As you came in, you may have also found a card like this. It isn't a reservation, it is actually a card that we will be using during our Coffee Knowledge Cafe activity. So I kindly ask you to keep them safely with you. We will be using them during an activity, during the Knowledge Cafe session. To bring to your announcement, to your attention, we have a secretariat desk that you noticed as we registered coming in this morning. They are a dedicated team available to you for any questions, queries. They are there to assist you. You may have also noticed personnel dressed in bright orange t-shirts. They are the go-to people in case you need some assistance on anything. We have washroom facilities just outside this door. We have the ladies first and then the gentlemen. So please feel free to access them as and when you need them. Later in the day, there will be a media team. This is a World Bank in-house media team that will be capturing some of these proceedings and may approach some of you for interviews. I hope that you will graciously allow them to interview you and just share your insights and experiences regarding the reason why we are here for this conference. All right, so I am done with the housekeeping. I will now transition us into the formal opening of our program. And just to remind us, the ladies and gentlemen, honorable guests, distinguished ladies and gentlemen, we are here convening as representatives from multiple sectors, different countries, all coming in to take stock of the experiences we have had on building institutional and operational capacities around knowledge sharing. The purpose of this is also to deepen our understanding of how knowledge sharing can contribute to the effectiveness of World Bank operations that are ongoing in our different nations. So overall, our theme for today will be achieving the Sustainable Development Goals through country-led knowledge sharing. And to give us our opening remarks, it is my pleasure to welcome up on stage our Senior Vice President of Operations here at the World Bank Group, Mr. Kyle Peters. Kindly give an applause as we welcome him up to make the opening remarks.
Okay, is this on? Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the forum. It's a really pleasure to be here. This is the third high-level meeting on country-led knowledge sharing. I think it's as we go forward into the agenda for the SDGs and development, we'll see that really one of the most important, biggest challenges we face is really the challenge of knowledge, finding the knowledge, finding what works, sharing what works, and scaling up what works, all to solve development problems. The problem seems to be, in most cases, less finance, less opportunities, but how to mobilize the finance to seize the opportunities and find the solutions through knowledge. And that's really what this key knowledge exchange partnership is about. Most of the solutions and many of the solutions, what we find in the World Bank, and I think what everyone finds, most of the solutions are often known but hidden. They're tucked away in the heads of staff members, either in your ministries, in civil society, a local official. We have a lot of task team leaders that know a lot. So the real challenge is how do we capture that knowledge and codify that knowledge and convey that knowledge so that we can take advantage of that to solve problems across the globe. And I think that's what this meeting is really all about. It's an opportunity for us to talk about how we can establish platforms, how we can really exchange knowledge, what's the most efficient ways of doing that, and then sort of all mobilize for effective how-to knowledge for development. I think this is the third high-level meeting, but it's interesting because this process has come a long way. In fact, someone reminded me as organizing the session that we really started to think about this probably in Bogota, in Colombia, in 2010, as we started the journey on self-self learning and knowledge exchange. And then we sort of established a political mandate for how to think about South-South cooperation and knowledge sharing in the Busan Plan for Action, and I think it was in 2011. And so those really sort of formed the nucleus, the hub of the beginning of the idea of this knowledge exchange. And then the first meeting was in Indonesia in 2012. The group sort of started to come together to start talking about knowledge sharing and engage in knowledge sharing. And so, and about, I think now we have, I mean, we many countries, about 800 people, have a community of practice of about 800 members and started offering online opportunities, knowledge sharing resources. And then this expanded again, I think, in Seoul 2 years ago. And Mr. Choi will, I guess, talk about that, my co-opening, and with over 600 participants from 75 countries. And I think it's sort of catalyzed a lot of thinking and a lot of progress for action. And I think to note that the Ministry of Transport in Afghanistan, subsequently coming out of the Seoul conference, sort of developed its own knowledge strategy and began to take action in solving development problems through knowledge sharing. And I hope they're here to share their experience with us. So this is the third high level meeting. It's another milestone along the journey. There are about 1,000 people from 78 countries participating, development partners, World Bank staff. I was a little worried there were going to be 1,000 people in this room when I spoke. But anyway, I think there are people connected through the webcast. There are people watching this on their computers in the World Bank. And there are people throughout the world looking at this. So it's a really sort of coming together of the movement and really what countries can do more to systematically harness knowledge, exchange knowledge, and improve service delivery, capturing a lot of local experiences. This is another, I think, experience we have in the World Bank, is that really a lot of things are going on in local communities, in local areas, in developing countries, that if we can just figure out how to capture that and make it more available, I think it will have a really strong effect in terms of improving development outcomes across the globe. And we really need to talk about how we can capture that knowledge and how we can move that knowledge. And that's one of the things we've been trying to do in the World Bank. I mean, we're in a year and a half into a new realigned model, into a new operating model, where we try to bring all of our sectoral expertise together, to bring it to a global matrix so that we have a global practice on each of the sectoral themes, and it's helped us in two ways. I think it's really helped us bring the global conversations like this conversation more in line with the operational work that the World Bank does throughout the globe. It's also put together all of our experts, so the experts in Asia and the experts in Latin America, the experts in Africa, all in one practice and in a better position to share knowledge and to share hands-on experience. And I think we've begun to see a lot of collaboration even within the World Bank and a lot of knowledge sharing. I think we have a long way to go. And in terms of sharing knowledge and having a system that conveys knowledge, both understanding the knowledge from outside and bringing it into the World Bank, both bringing the knowledge within the World Bank across the globe, as well as bringing the knowledge that we have in regions to other regions. So it's something that we really want to work with you. We want to learn from you. We want to establish platforms so that we can, that it's not only south-south, but south-north, west-east, east-west. I mean, how we can just move knowledge around more effectively. And I think trying to build country capacity for knowledge sharing and country capacity in general is something that we've emphasized under the IDA 17 replenishment, which is our IDA being our fund for the poorest countries. So we're trying to, we've recognized how essential it is for development. And we tried to also bring into all of our lending operations and our knowledge products, we're trying to bring in knowledge platforms and South-South learning so that we can increasingly help country institutions, we can increasingly help ourselves to really share solutions and use tested approaches. Just some of the things we have going on here that I think we'll highlight over the next few days is our global partnership on knowledge sharing, which really continuously sharing knowledge sharing across the bank, across the globe. And then we have a global delivery initiative, which is really looking at knowledge base for practical service delivery, the how-to of doing things. A lot of times we're really good on the theory, but the actual implementation and the how to do something really needs a lot of support and a lot of enrichment and a lot of growth. And then last is the South. We have a donor-funded South-South facility. It's funded by 9 donors, including China, Colombia, India, Indonesia, Mexico, and Russia. And we have financed nearly 200 exchanges with more than 100 countries. So I think there's a lot going on in the bank. There's a lot going on that you're doing and the institutions are doing, civil society is doing, bilateral institutions, multilateral institutions. And I think we're really here to bring you all together, to learn from you, to catalyze the thinking, and to see how we can be more efficient. So I think some of the challenges we have before us is how do we make knowledge sharing the norm and build it into our systems and culture is something we're really focused on in the World Bank. How to better capture and share knowledge and to share solutions more efficiently, effectively, and more agile across all of our clients, across all of the countries. And then how do we really increase the knowledge flow? As I said, this is not just north to south, but it's really south to south, it's south to north. We have a lot of examples now as we begin to work with some countries that have been adversely affected by the slowdown in Europe, where we've taken things that we've learned from countries that we've worked in and client countries and transferred them to what we call sort of developed countries. So there's a lot of south to north. There's also a lot of work going on social protection systems that we've transferred into developed countries. So it's really an open platform. It's like a global platform. It's like not only south-south, but it's south-north, west-east, as I said. So we really need to continue to think about how we can increase the knowledge flow and use that learning. I'd just like to conclude by, I spoke, Mr. Choi, I think is going to follow me, our executive director from Korea, and I just want to say that we really thank our co-organizers from Korea for their sustained leadership with us on this knowledge sharing agenda, and have been a partner for us since going back a number of years, and we've really established an office in Korea that's also very active in this knowledge sharing South-South exchange. So I just wish you all a good meeting the next couple of days, realizing that we have a very daunting agenda ahead of us in terms of the sustainable development goals and ending extreme poverty and boosting shared prosperity, which is a core thing of the bank. And we really want to learn from you, and we want to work with you and to see how we can move forward really to change the lives of people in the world. So thank you very much for allowing me to open the conference.
Thank you very much, Mr. Kyle Peters. It is now our pleasure to welcome up on stage Dr. Hee-nam Choi, who is the Executive Director of the Republic of Korea with the World Bank Group. A warm welcome to you, sir.
Thank you for your kind introduction, Peter. Good morning, Senior Vice President Kyle Peters, and honorable ministers and distinguished guests. I wish you all warm welcome to the third high-level meeting on country-led knowledge sharing. The Republic of Korea is delighted to co-host this important meeting. It is a pleasure to see so many familiar faces again since Korea hosted the second high-level meeting, or HLM2, in Seoul in June 2014. HLM2 signified an important milestone that helped us to define practical approaches countries can take to develop institutional capacity for knowledge sharing. Korea has experienced a remarkable success in combining a rapid economic growth with significant improvements in key areas such as human development and ICT and infrastructure. Korea is an exceptional example of an aid recipient turned to a donor country and a high-income country with the GDP per capita increasing rapidly from $1,000 in 1960 to $27,000 in 2015. And life expectancy at birth rising significantly from 53 years in 1960 to 82 years in 2013. Since 1955, Korea has been a close partner of World Bank for over 60 years. Now the world's third largest economy, Korea is a key development partner of the World Bank Group and important contributor to AIDA and a unique international donor. The first World Bank-Korea successful partnership was through the Economic Development Institute, EDI, now we call it LLI. And this program has evolved, expanded, and continued 60 years later to existing on productive partnership on global program on knowledge sharing, which is supporting today's meeting that brings us together here today. Currently, Korea has a series of diverse and innovative partnerships and programs with the World Bank Group across all the World Bank Group global practice, GP, and cross-cutting solution areas designed to inter alia enhance financial sector management, promote investment in green infrastructure and renewable energy, share know-how in information communication technology, support and accelerate knowledge sharing, as well as assist fragile and conflict states through various trust funds. Knowledge sharing is a key pillar of Korea's development assistance. In 2004, Korea launched Korea Knowledge Sharing Program, or KSP, a new paradigm of development cooperation. It aims to share the Korea's development know-how, assisting partner countries to work toward lessening the knowledge divide. KSP offers comprehensive policy consultations tailored to needs of partner countries, encompassing in-depth analysis, policy consultation, and training opportunities. Let me more elaborate on the KSP program. The KSP firmly stands on three pillars. First pillar, or policy consultation, provides policy consultation centered on needs of partner countries. Starting with only two countries in 2004, number has grown to 46 countries by 2013. Pillar 1 offers comprehensive development assistance programs to countries that include in-depth analysis, policy recommendation on priority policy areas, and policy training workshops for practitioners of partner countries based on Korea's economic development experience. Second pillar, a joint consultation with international organizations, combines lessons drawn from Korea's development experience with international organizations' development consulting expertise. KSP consultants work closely with organizations like the World Bank to support technical assistance and cooperation projects of international organizations. For example, 2014, KSP supported development of civic partnership ICT system through mobile and big data to improve water supply and sewage service in Mumbai, India. Through a joint consultation between Export-Import Bank of Korea and World Bank, the objective was to help the city of Mumbai enjoy sustainable growth by improving the public service of its water supply and sewage services. The study suggests ways to improve civic participation with ICT in water supply and sewage services, established a roadmap and designed a conceptual model of a civic participation system, and developed the civil participation system to upgrade the public service of water supply and sewage services. How about the third pillar? Modularization of Korea development experience produced detailed case studies on Korea's development experience, documenting policy, their implementation and outcomes, institution building process, and public projects that had greatly contributed to Korea economic development. To date, the KSP has produced 144 cases on wide diversity of themes, ranging from macroeconomics and labor to education and public health. Korea's intensive interest in knowledge and learning led to establishment in 2013 of a new partnership with the World Bank through Global Knowledge Program on Knowledge Sharing. The global program has become a key resource to foster a World Bank Group Korea collaboration on development, scale up global knowledge sharing and learning platforms, and supporting direct delivery of knowledge sharing between practitioners. The global program helps enable the World Bank Group and country partners to catalyze and accelerate sustainable development solutions. On the global program, we are pleased to see increasing result and impact with many country partners that are represented here today, including Federal Ministry of Agriculture and Rural Development of Nigeria, and the Ministry of Health of India, and Indonesia's National Agency for Disaster Management. I strongly believe this work with your government agency helps professionalize the capacity of capturing and sharing your successful development experience, both internally as well as domestically and internationally with other countries. Korea itself also understands the importance of role of institutional capacity for knowledge sharing. We are very pleased that the World Bank is working closely with Korea Development Institute, or KDI, as part of organizational knowledge sharing work to help KDI sharpen its knowledge sharing tools and approaches. KDI was founded in 1971 in recognition of the need of a think tank that researches economic policy issues concerning Korea in both systemic and applicable ways to assist the government in formulating the five-year economic development plans and related policies. This partnership between the World Bank and KDI will continue supporting KDI's key role and responsibility as Korea's leading economic think tank. Over the next 2 days, country partners, international development organizations, and wide range of development partners will have an opportunity to actively learn from each other on what countries can do to better document and share development solutions. I hope the third high-level meeting will serve as a key pillar, key milestone toward showcasing the progress made by country institutions, leading to a new knowledge sharing culture, sharing evidence of contribution of effective knowledge sharing to improving service delivery, and highlighting the opportunities for integrating knowledge sharing in World Bank Group lending operation and advisor service. Finally, let me summarize today's event like this. If you have knowledge, let others light their candles at it. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much for those opening remarks. It's my pleasure now to present to us our keynote speaker. This gentleman is the global knowledge, is the lead of the Global Knowledge Management Department unit at Enterprise Services Microsoft. In this capacity, he leads a 21,000 strong global workforce through a groundbreaking transformation that has a single goal. This single goal is to create more value with a best-in-class knowledge collaboration. In this capacity, he has overseen Microsoft Services' knowledge management strategy, programs, processes, and tools since May 2012. It is my pleasure to present to you, once again, our keynote speaker, Mr. Jean-Claude Monnet. Kindly give him an applause to welcome him.
Thank you, Tricia. Thank you. Can you hear me? Good morning. I'm really so excited to be here with people that came from all over the world and are interested about knowledge sharing, because my passion is knowledge management. So this is for me an honor to be here, and thank you for the World Bank to have me. And I hope you are going to see that there are quite some interesting parallels between the world I am in, which is the business world, and the public sector world. When I think of Zika or the terrorism challenges that we are all facing, there is no way that one single person or country will be able to solve these problems. It requires a massive knowledge sharing of knowledge. And for me, there is no doubt that knowledge management is the new leadership management discipline for companies and nation to build sustainable value. When I think of value, you can think of the business end, but value can take different forms. And of course, I come from the private sector. That's the world I know. But I think that there are many, many opportunities of similarities between our two worlds. And what is very interesting is the fact that most of us, when we graduated, we were not educated in knowledge management. It was not a leadership management discipline. We learned about finance, we learned about HR, we learned about a lot of things, but we did not learn about knowledge management. And it's very hard to find even today universities that have knowledge management in their curriculum. And I wish we can change that and really bring that out. So how did it start for me? Well, back in 1999, I was working for the fifth largest semiconductor company called STMicroelectronics, which is a French-Italian company headquartered in Geneva, Switzerland, where I'm coming from. And one day our CEO came and he said, what if we can use the collective knowledge of our company to shape our future? And we were just sitting there, all the group vice president, looking at each other, and he said, what is he talking about? You know, like we had no clue what knowledge management was. So what we did is that we did our homework. We went to the academia, we talked to our customers, to our partners, and eventually, 6 months later, we published a playbook that you can see here. And we defined four major initiatives that we wanted to drive. And the very interesting things out of those four initiatives, two failed and two succeeded. And the two that failed, they failed for the same reason. That was culture. We misunderstood culture. Let me give you an example. There's one of those that says design reuse. Well, you would think that is common sense that you tell an engineer to reuse a piece of code that somebody has designed so that you can do your solution faster and you can do it with more quality. Makes sense, right? Well, but engineers, they are not there to copy. They're there to create. We had not thought about that, right? And that's really fascinating to do that. So what happened to the two others that succeeded? Well, the two others that succeeded, one of them, I was actually part of the online community one. And remember, this is 1999, so there was not many community tool at the time. Actually, my team had to build a tool at the time. But it's interesting is that there we had a very clear objective. The vice president of manufacturing said, I have 8 factories around the world. I want to increase my return on net asset. It was very clear. So how do you increase the return on net asset of a factory? You improve the yield. You improve the throughput of the factory. So would it be great that we can capture the knowledge of all the 8 factories around the world, find the best practice, and redistribute that knowledge to all the factories? And guess what happened? It worked. $10 million on the bottom line the first year. $10 million additional profit on the first year with no change in equipment, no change in people, just by doing knowledge sharing. So we understood at that time that you need to have a very clear business goal, you need to have a very clear process, and that people were very important into that process. So through that experience, I learned something I didn't learn because I was not educated that way. It was about something we call communities of practice. And many people put the word communities to a distribution list or to a Yammer group or whatever. No, 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 this is very different. Community of practice is really comes from a science. There's a science behind this. And it's rooted in the deepest human behavior. If you think about how we grew up as human, the first thing we did, we got together in community to protect ourselves from the element, right? And that sense, that very inner fiber of us to group ourselves to do something more is what community of practice really is. It's about this craft or this passion for a particular domain that we need to do. In my previous example, one thing that we actually also did not really realize is that we didn't know what to do with that knowledge management thing. And while the design of organization is very clear to have, you know, CEOs, CFOs, CMOs, etc., at the time there was not really a place for something like a chief knowledge officer or whatever. And so we put that responsibility under the quality vice president. And we did not invest into an organization. We did not build a role. And like Kyle was just mentioning this morning, if you don't have a global approach to this, it will not work. And eventually what happened, sadly, this initiative died. So when I looked at some of the lessons learned for me is that the first thing is that you really want to have some very clear outcome and metrics, know exactly, not the knowledge management people should do that, the business, the people who are, you know, the recipient of the knowledge management should have a clear understanding of what outcome do they want, right? Do they want to increase, you know, the score in teaching? Do they want, what is it that they want to do? Then we have those metrics. Then you have to tie this with the knowledge collaboration culture. If you don't put those two things together, then you probably will fail there. And again, it's this organization that you need to have. While knowledge sharing is the responsibility of everyone in the organization, okay, the people that are managing this, who develop the strategies, you want to be more efficient, and so you want to centralize this kind of activity, and then have a decentralized organization that can amplify the central program. So there are some very tangible results for knowledge management. And I get this question all the time, you know, what are the results? Can you show me some metrics and so on? And there is a very important association in the US called the American Productivity and Quality Center, who drove the TQM culture and the quality culture, the Malcolm Baldrige Award, for those of you who are in the US. And this place is where a lot of knowledge management is happening, where probably many of some of the people representative here have are member of APQC. And they do this this survey, and they look at what's the return on asset and what's the return on sales that people, the return on investment that people have. And you see that when you have a very low maturity of knowledge management, you're doing fairly poorly. So there's a direct correlation between being a knowledge-driven enterprise and your financial results. Last year, Microsoft was awarded for the 18th times the most admired knowledge enterprise. And yeah, we're proud of this because it's always good to be awarded something. But more importantly is that this has been part of a very long-term commitment that we've made to sharing knowledge inside the company. And the MAKE organization that does that survey, it's completely independent. They actually relate financial performance. And you can see that if you look at the total return of shareholder value or the return on asset compared to the peers of the industry is fascinating. So there is a direct correlation between leadership, knowledge sharing, enterprises or government, and the financial outcome. So you're probably all familiar here with Microsoft, but you're probably not as familiar with the biggest division of Microsoft, which is actually a service division. And this is my world. This is where I globally operate. It's a very diverse world, so I'm very lucky to have to work with people from all over the world in different cultures. We are almost going to be 22,000 people this year. So it's a very, very interesting challenge. And our mission is really to help our enterprise customer do more and achieve more in this mobile-first, cloud-first world. And I'm going to talk a little bit about that because I think it's very important to all of us to really grasp this opportunity there. So one of the things that is happening, and you all probably read this, it is about this major digital shift that is happening. And those of you who follow the World Economic Forum, the theme of the World Economic Forum was the Fourth Industrial Revolution, which the digital shift is one of the three main pillars there. And it's very interesting to think of all what happened in the last few years. You're all familiar probably with Uber, which I just checked yesterday has a market cap of $51 billion. Uber owns no car. They're bigger than Avis and Hertz combined, right? You've heard about Airbnb that owns no apartment, nothing. Bitcoin that actually transformed me. So all these, this digital shift means that the world is transforming so rapidly right now and pushing the establishment. And it's happening in the public sector and the private sector at the same time. So we have to rethink the way we do things. And when I looked at what we do at Microsoft, we decided to really be in the middle of that transformation. For ourselves, it's grounded in both the world in which we live and the future we strive to create. So when we talk about mobile first and cloud first, what is very important is not to think of mobile as a device. This is not what we mean. It's about mobility of people, a mobility of the user experience. And it's, imagine a world when the devices are interchangeable. You arrive into a place and you have a device. It's not the device that makes you, it's how your mobility is important. So when we talk about this mobile first, cloud first world, we're not talking about the device, but really talking about the mobility of the user experience. And the cloud is where the truth is. We're investing billions of dollars in the cloud. And that's where the knowledge sharing is happening, right? If you look at the internet itself, it's a cloud, right? And what is very important is the cloud is this great equalizer, because it provides people, you know, with no investment in infrastructure, access to knowledge. So it's very important that you know, appreciate the importance of those two very important components, and not to really think of it as a technology-only thing, and certainly for the mobile, not just as a device. So as I was preparing this, I was thinking of something very close to all of us' heart, is how education is happening and so on, how we help people. And I have to admit, I got a little bit of a Kenya course before coming here, because this picture is Beatrice Dorongo, who is the principal in Gakawa Secondary School in Nanyuki in Kenya. And I apologize for the Kenyan delegate if my pronunciation is not very, very correct. But she's an amazing woman. She's the head of a school who has now wonderful kids. And to her left is Tibita Wanjiku Kieru. She's a 17 years old student. And what you see on the back, this mat, is very, very important for them, because it changed their life and the life of the entire community they are in. On the top of the mat is a microwave receiver. And below the mat, you can see a satellite dish. And that's where the real magic is, because that satellite dish is a Wi-Fi antenna that broadcasts Wi-Fi for 10 miles around. 10 miles around. So now, people can have access to that cloud of knowledge that they didn't have before. And for me, it's really a fascinating experience. And I think that better than words, let me just roll this video for you.
If you look around the world today, there are about 3.3 billion people in the world who are online. What that means is, if you look at the total world population, about 7.3 billion, there are about 4 billion then who are actually not online. We think TV white space is the type of technology that can help to get that last few billion people in the world connected.
Mawingo is a solar-powered nomadic Wi-Fi internet service provider. And we focus on delivering connectivity over TV white space spectrum in rural areas where there is no internet or electricity. TV white space is the use of the gaps in between television channels.
The internet is important for everyone in the world. Kenya is no different. People, they may not live with electricity, but the internet is as important to them. It really is. Without it, we can't be included in so many different things.
3 years ago, we were asked by Microsoft if we could help out in Kenya. We came to Nanyuki to deploy the pilot network. The rural communities around Nanyuki, they had no internet before we arrived. Using our solar-powered base stations, with a combination of TV white space and microwave, we've got a lot of communities, villages, and schools that have now got true broadband internet.
We have actually been able to implement our pilot in four particular places. We have been at Kakawa Secondary School. We have been at Tabuzi Farm, the container next to the Tabuzi Farm. And even further, we have even done Olpajeta. And the kind of transformational impact it will have is huge.
Our internet is supplied by Mawingu. It is Mawingu that brought us to the limelight.
Having internet power and device, you have the whole world. Everyone will be coming to believe internet can change life of people from this place.
The benefit to our community of having fast, reliable and affordable connectivity, I think, is something that we're only starting to see the beginning of its impact. And we expect to see that grow and grow.
The destiny of one's life is in one's hands. If they use all these facilities, they have a future for themselves, bright future.
You're at a terrible disadvantage if you haven't got access to the internet. There are another 4 billion people to connect. That is closing the digital divide.
Well, I hope you find this fascinating as I found it fascinating. And while other people are trying to fly drones or have balloons, We've been helping people, bridging that digital divide by using a very simple thing that was the free space of the airwave of the broadcast television antenna. And that's the kind of commitment we have to the communities. And I told you that we are very much knowledge sharing enterprise, and it goes with what we're doing also with the community. So the question is, why is knowledge management so strategic? Well, it's too important to fail. We will not have another chance as an industry to fail. We need to put our sharing of knowledge together to fight those big battles, like terrorism, like Zika. And when I think of terrorism, if you think about the government, they understood the importance of knowledge very early on, because they have things like Central Intelligence Agency. Intelligence is knowledge, right? But it's only 10 years ago they realized that if they share the profile of criminals and they make it public, that they could accelerate catching criminals. Until then, they were keeping that secret under the vest. So they learned one very important thing, which probably many of you have heard, is working out loud. Okay, try to share to people that you don't know. We all have been programmed here, at least I've been, like, you have to share on a need-to-know basis, right? So you send that email to that person, right? But what if somebody else needs that information? We'll never get it. So we have to change the way we think, like sharing on the need-not-to-know basis. This is cultural. This is not going to happen easily. We have to let go of what we've been educated with. We have to adapt. And we're good at adapting. That's why we're here today. It's our strength as a species. So what are the strategic value creation drivers? And I told you I come from the private sector, so of course I'm going to talk about that space. So the first thing is product excellence, or service excellence if you're in a service industry. And what is fascinating about it is that, what is innovation? Innovation is what drives product excellence, right? I see so many phones here, like taking pictures, right? It's interesting that when you take your phone and you look at the picture and you rotate your phone, the picture rotates. That was a great innovation, right? We didn't have to turn the head, right? But innovation is not invention. The invention was the people who invented the motion sensors. The innovation was to put the motion sensors in the phone. So innovation is about reusing of ideas or method of others. So that's what knowledge sharing does. That's why it's good. The second very important area is operational excellence. And I really think there is a very close relationship between our two worlds, the public and the private sector world here, because productivity is what is driving operational excellence, right? So when you reuse something, you are far more predictable in the time it takes to do it. You are far more predictable in the quality of your output, right? And so if you look at the traditional productivity levers that we had, was to automate business processes, right? We're going to automate processes. But in a fast-changing world like ours, the opportunity for automation of processes are reducing. So we have to find new ways of bringing productivity. And that's where knowledge sharing and knowledge reuse are very important. And if I looked at productivity, when basically productivity grew 3% per annum, you basically double the standard of living of one generation. 3% per annum, you double the standard of living. So when you look at the goals of the World Bank, there's very much there, right? We want to reduce the level of poverty, right? So we want to increase the standard of living. So productivity of the government, of the institution, making more people succeeded at school, you know, and so on, have a better healthcare system, have a better security system, is very important to all of us. And then the third pillar is what I call knowledge excellence. And that's the new discipline that we're here to talk about, is to put our arms around those concepts of knowledge sharing and reuse. Because if it was sharing alone, we would know by now that it would work. No, sharing is putting the information out there. Somebody else has to find it and reuse it. And sometimes be willing to ask. Again, another culture thing. In one thing I've learned at Microsoft Services, not every culture is willing to ask. We have to help people understand those differences in culture, because in some places they will not ask. So that's a very important area there. So knowledge excellence has three major pillars. The first one is you need to have a vision. And I wrote that vision after a knowledge management conference where I saw a general from the US Army talking about how they use knowledge in the field. And what they had is they had that soldiers with their helmet with the camera on the top. And there was a group of people there. And the question was, are those people friends or are they enemies? Are they blow up? Are they going to blow up in front of me, or are they going to be friends, right? So what happened is the camera was linked to a command center. There was face recognition. They would look for the people, and then they would transmit to the people on the helmet that those are friends. So I took my phone, and I typed on my OneNote and said, instant, relevant knowledge in context. That's the ultimate goal. Imagine if every time you have to do something, you have all the knowledge you need to do the job. So at Microsoft Services, when we have our consultant go and help companies to do their job, they're not hiring that consultant knowledge. They're hiring the 120,000 people knowledge behind them. So my job is to bring the knowledge of the entire organization through that person. And that's what a vision is very important. Because everything we do, it's like the way of life. We give the people a way of life, a way of thinking, a direction. And that's very important. And it works really well. The second thing is a strategy. There's nothing new about strategy, but what is a knowledge management strategy decision? There are two ways where knowledge flows. One way that is formal, and for us, everything we do is a project. So we have a customer project, the customer wants a particular outcome, and we work with the customer. This is a formal process. So we have a knowledge sharing process which has six major steps that basically, at each of the step, we have a very defined process of what's happening and how we capture the knowledge, how we codify knowledge. And we have one thing that is very important. We have assigned a value to knowledge. So what does it mean to have value of knowledge? The knowledge that is the most reusable has the highest value, so that I can codify that knowledge. So instead of going on my search engine and typing, and it's like finding a needle in a haystack, I can make some little needle stack and just search in the needle stack and find what I want. And the difference is that when you type, or you go on the internet, you type something, you know what is the average word that people type on the search box? 1.5. 1.5. So even the best search engine in the world could not give you something, because you're searching for, customer relationship management. That's already three words. But they type CRM. And they want what? CRM presentation, CRM architecture, CRM what? So we have to find another way to discover the knowledge. And that's why you need to assign a category of value to knowledge. So that's in the strategy. Now, we focus on the flow of work, because this is where we capture the most knowledge. Because every time we do a project, we don't have all the answers. So we're building answers as we work with our customers, and we capture those answers. Then we look at the reusability, we curate those answers, and then we promote those answers. We tell other people, hey, you know what? We know how to do this. You know? Why don't you look at this? Why don't you do that? Now, we have this informal flow of work that we're all working in, and now there's a revolution happening called artificial intelligence. And what we see is that machine learning and artificial intelligence is going to learn about what you do in the background, because you're connected, right? And it's going to start to fetch knowledge for you that you are connected with. So there's a brand new world starting there that is fascinating also. And the third element that you really need to have there is an execution framework. You need to really have a framework to do that. And at the World Bank, there is a very interesting framework that was developed, the capacity maturity framework, that is very much like something you can reuse and really apply to redrive your knowledge initiative. So again, for me, what was the lesson learned in doing this? So we've been doing this for 11 years at Microsoft Services. So we started really with a simple idea to capture the knowledge in every project and create a committee of practice. But the most important was to have a vision. We had a little failures because we didn't have a clear vision. So people were not working all in the same direction. We lost efficiency. And it's unclear when we had that very clear, simple vision that everybody can remember, you don't need the textbooks about it, then it changed really and put all the energy of the company together. And then really look at the strategies to focus. Focus on the desired outcome. You can't do it all. You have to be courageous and say, no, I'm not going to do this. I'm going to do this extremely well. I'm not going to do this. No is very difficult, especially for managers, right? We tend to want to be nice to people, but you have to say no. Those of you who have children, you know that, right? So you have to say no also. But finally, the framework. One thing we've learned is that a framework is to be consistent. So you need to consistently present to people what you're doing. People have million things in their mind. Leaders have million things in their mind. They can't, one day they're talking about knowledge management, the next day they're talking about a retirement plan for the employee, the next thing they're talking about a new office they have to open. They need something very consistent that they can always see from you there, and so they understand what you're doing. So communication becomes key. Communicate, communicate, communicate is really important. So I talk about the heart and soul of any knowledge initiatives, which is the community of practice. I just want to give an example of what it is for us. It started in 2005, so 11 years ago. And we align the activities of those committees with our three strategic imperatives in terms of value creation. And we're very, very proud that now we actually grew constantly in the last 11 years. We just passed, actually, last month, our 20,000 unique members there. Now, I told you we were about 22,000 people in Microsoft Services. So we only have 60% of people in Microsoft Services, and 30% comes from Microsoft Research, Microsoft IT, all the product groups. So we have really, you know, leading the way on how to do knowledge sharing inside the whole Microsoft as a whole there. And it's very important. And we have a category of people we call subject matter experts. They are the deep knowledge people. There are a lot of companies that are spending money developing very sophisticated systems to find knowledge. Let me give you a real, real, you know, low-cost advice. Use people. All what you need in our system is two click. Community, chase the community, and you find all the subject matter experts. Two click. With two click, you find the expert. You have your presence. You know if they're online. You can right-click and IM them and ask them a question. If they don't know, the beauty of a subject matter expert, if that person doesn't know, he or she doesn't know, he or she knows who knows. So you find it very quickly. And that's all what we are after. When you think that, you know, employees in companies, in your institution, spend 15% in average to search for information, if not more, the productivity gain to have access to knowledge like that. So again, for me, there has been a lot of lesson learned in communities. And as I said, communities is not a distribution list or a Yammer group. But one thing I've learned is that they can either evolve naturally, again, because of the deep science of how humans are you know, built there, or they can be created very deliberately with a particular goal in mind. But there's two things that is very important. One is you want diversity in a community. So all our community are global, number one. So there are people from all over the world, and they are not specific to a role. So if I take, for example, the cloud community have people in sales, in research, in support, in consulting, architect, all the roles. And that is the richness. Diversity of thoughts is a richness in a community. The second thing is that how do you understand if the community is working? So we actually created a community health index. It was a very empirical model. You know, we just decided to have a system with 1,000 points and pick 7 KPIs and figure out, you know, how is the health of the community. And the community has a life cycle. The XP community is dead, of course, you know. But you have new community. The latest community is our smart city community. It's got 300 people. And those 300 people have a medium response time of 9 minutes. Those are people who don't know each other. They are all over the world, but they care for each other. And out of the 95 communities we have a third of those communities that have a median response time below 1 hour. Now, this we're talking about agility in a company. This is agility. When you put that collective knowledge sharing together to help each other. So I just wanted to go back to culture. I'm sorry, but if I would not do my job well of sharing all what I've learned there. And it's a fascinating for me because Peter Drucker in 1966, when he wrote the book, The Effective Executive, he said, oh, you know, by 2020, we're gonna live in a knowledge worker society. That's gonna replace basically all what we're doing in terms of manufacturing resource. The new renewable resource actually is knowledge. Think about it. And for me, it's something that, yeah, we all probably heard this. And then he came to realize, and this is a famous quote that I think is attributed to him. I could not find it in any of the book I had from Peter Drucker, but I hear that his culture eats strategy for breakfast. You can have the best strategy if you don't put the culture with it. And I'm writing a book right now, and so I'm doing a lot of clipping of information and so on. And I was clipping this article on the Wall Street Journal when GM has that unfortunate recall. And the interesting thing is that it was titled, cultural failing. They had the process in place. They did not have the culture that was making people share the knowledge. And if you go to the NASA, those of you who know about the Columbia failure, my friend Ed Hoffman, who is the chief knowledge officer of the NASA, told me, they knew about the O-ring. They knew, the engineer knew it would not work. They didn't know who to tell. And people lost their lives. So this is why culture is very important. I'm very happy, I'm sure, as a Microsoft shareholder, that you buy all the technology you want. But if you don't, put the culture in front, you're not gonna succeed. So I want to give you one more proof, which is how sad this is happening in our industry, in the technology industry. And we have an association called the Technology Services Industry Association, and every year we do a knowledge management survey. And you can see that half of the knowledge management initiative died the first year. Half, and two-thirds within 3 years. Now think about the investment in dollar that those people did. We as a technology supplier are very unhappy with that because if our customers are not getting the output that they want, we are not happy. So that's why we're telling them, it's not just about the technology. You need to really look at what goes around the technology. So when we talk about culture, I want to make it very tangible. I want to share with you what that means about having a leadership culture sharing organization like we have at Microsoft. And culture is the sum of behaviors that you can see in a company, right? Nothing new. So it's your company values, you know, integrity, honesty, you know, caring about your communities, and so on. It's about the performance and development management system. So 2 years ago, Microsoft did something very bold. We used to be stack rank. So to get my bonus, I was competing with peers, right? And only, you know, one would get and the other one would not get, right? So what does it mean to my behavior? It means that I was not incentivized to share. So we change our performance management system and we have three things now. One, we said, okay, did you do your sales quota? Did you write the code on time, on quality? Okay, check. Second, show me what knowledge you have reused to create a bigger impact. Show me. And show me what knowledge you have shared intentionally to make somebody else create a bigger impact. And every 3 months, we have a meeting with the employee. I just had mine with my my team. And they come forward and they said, okay, this is what I've done. I gave a speech at TechReady and I help people understand the how to manage performance on the cloud. And this is what I did. There was 150 people in a room and you know this kind of thing. Now people take their accountability to show you what they're doing. There is no metric. There's no like you have to do 10 or 5 or whatever. What you want is the behavior change. It's not a question of numbers. It's a question is that before you start to do something, ask yourself, is there somebody else that has done it in my government, in my institution, across the world, in my domain? Because if you ask yourself that question, you will be far more richer, far more knowledgeable, far more competitive in anything you do. So that's the foundation. You need to have that foundation. You don't have that foundation, it's very hard to build from that. Once you have that foundation to build a knowledge culture organization, you have three main pillars. And I use the word citizenship here because I want to think of accountability, right? Like we are as citizens, we have accountabilities as citizens. So the first thing is being collaborative, that collaboration. What does it mean to collaborate? Well, it means to share, to be willing to reuse, and to be willing to work together to grow the knowledge. When two people come with one knowledge, they leave each of them with two knowledge, right? And they can grow the knowledge, that's the third one. It's very important behavior. The second one is to have a social citizenship. Because the knowledge now is fundamentally social. I said there is no single person or nation that can solve the complex problem we're facing today. We have to crowdsource the social knowledge. But social is not, you know, evident for everyone. There are people who are not willing to ask questions. So connecting is the first step. Connect with somebody else, right? The second thing is to communicate. Again, we need to improve. There's languages. If I speak French to you right now, I'm sure only 10% of the audience would understand what I'm saying. So you will see tools coming for translation, automatic translation, video translation, and so on, to bring the knowledge to people, right? There are a lot of great things happening right now in China, let me tell you. But for me, I don't speak Chinese. I'm completely out of that knowledge. Would it be great I can learn from all this knowledge? And the same thing with other countries. So it's very important we think about this. And the third area is what I call the digital literacy citizenship. We live in a digital world. So there are three things important there. One is really understand this concept of mobility that is not your device, is that if as leader, if you think about your knowledge sharing initiative, think about how can you make the people mobile in their experience. Mobile. So if you design a solution, it has to be mobile and experience, meaning that maybe they go to a kiosk, and the kiosk makes them mobile, right? Understanding the cloud is that place where the truth lives. That's infrastructure that is accessible to share knowledge. And that security and privacy is not the responsibility just of the government or the CIO or the IT department. It's everyone's responsibility. Don't be stupid about what you post and what you share. So my last lesson learned with you today is, and I think Carla Odell, who is the president and CEO of APQC, says it's the people that make the system work. And I think we have to focus on culture and have the leader walk the talk. So let me give you a little example of what it is to walk the talk. When somebody comes to me in my team and said, hey, Jean-Claude, we just finished that new project. We have 5,000 people connected on the outside to our knowledge sharing system. Well, so that's great. What ideas did you reuse to create that solution? What did you learn that you shared with others? So I encouraged them. I said, yeah, it's great. But very simple things to walk the talk, right? You as leader have that ability to walk the talk with a very simple attitude, to give the message that you care, it's important for your company or your organization there. The second thing is that, and I've learned that as a nuclear physicist engineer, I did not learn psychology. I had to learn psychology way after that. And I realized the importance of adoption and change management. It's another discipline that I didn't know well. And in fact, in my own team, I have a certified adoption change management person from this company, ProSci, that we use. It's not a Microsoft thing, it's something we use. So. But the interesting thing is they've done a survey in 2014, and you see that the project effectiveness more than tripled when, as a leader, you are behind a project. Triple chance of success. So I'd like to close this keynote today by saying that if you really can embrace that digital shift and combine it with that knowledge management leadership discipline, you can really drive this productivity increase that you want to raise the standard of living that is so important, to address complex challenges like Zika or terrorism, and allow every person on the planet to achieve more. So on behalf of Microsoft and I want to thank the World Bank and the Ministry of Strategy of Finance of Korea for this opportunity to share my knowledge management passion with you. And I'll be here for the next 2 days, or you can find me on the Knowledge Hubs, and I'll be glad to continue the conversation. Thank you.